Now, for the survivors, the scars of this ordeal will take a very long time to heal. Dr. Gary Banks is a clinical psychologist. He joins us on the panel now. Welcome, Doctor. Looking at these photos of the hostages fleeing the Lint Cafe yesterday, I mean, the pain, the terror is etched on their faces. I mean, how long will it take them to recover from something like this? Are we talking years of therapy?
We're talking a life-altering event. This is... No one's going to have a basis of comparison for this, so it is absolutely unique in Sydney's memory, in Australia's memory. So for the individuals that were in that cafe, it's going to be absolutely unique for them as well. So not only is it the difference of the event itself, it's the fact that they've got no resources available. They weren't prepared for it. They've got no resources to actually work out how to cope with it now, and that's where the work starts.
They must have thought, though, that they could be killed. And I wonder how they feel when two people that were there with them all were killed. And it makes me think that that there's sort of a camaraderie, I would think, among hostages when you're in that situation. So if you lose two out of the group, what sort of impact does that have on you?
There's not many words sufficient to describe this other than life-altering, and to keep focusing on what has happened to them for that moment, they would have been thinking, obviously and logically, where next? So the notion of I don't want it to be me, and then they would be doing what we would all do in that circumstance, is a life review. Where are my loved ones? What am I doing? Who do I want to talk to the most? This is when your life flashes before your eyes. All of those classic aspects that we look at within the critical trauma moment, they're occurring, or they have occurred.
Well, specifically, what sort of problems now do these freed and hostages and survivors face?
We take the recovery process, the psychological recovery process, in stages. So the immediate step now for this group is to actually help them achieve normality. So we talk about principles of psychological first aid. And first, obviously, as we've seen for the last 24 hours, is focus on safety above all else. So the basics of physical safety, and then their mental health. We focus on calmness. So you can see that the primary people that have been facilitating the resolution of this event have all spoken in calm, measured tones. So the group that are now being treated through the hospital system will be equally met with calm individuals to help them start, if you like, to get their heads around it. We help them promote connectedness. So we immediately help them assemble their family and their loved ones, all the ones that they would have been thinking about whilst they were there in the cafe. We would help them reconnect with those people. We would help them to focus on their own self-coping skills. We talk about it as self-efficacy, but their capacity to believe in themselves that they can carry on and get through this moment, and obviously into the days ahead. And the final bit is we promote hope. As the Commissioner just said, we are still Sydney and we are still Australia, and they will have themselves and their family, and they will, in a sense, circle the wagons and say, we will live another day, we will fight on.
Would any of them feel guilty, do you think, because they survived and two didn't?
Without a doubt. Without a doubt.
Really?
That will be a long-lasting residue of this.
And are there other symptoms that, other things that an event like this could trigger? I imagine everyone responds very differently to something like this. What other symptoms should perhaps their loved ones or people close to them look out for?
All I've mapped out is essentially the interventionist's first efforts within the first few hours of this sort of event. So beyond that, there are then long-term strategies available by way of therapy for the individual involved, for their immediate family, and then their immediate community. It has incredible ripple effects across, if you like, the community itself.
Gary, there must be also mental trauma to manage with regards to the victims' families now as well, what they went through overnight, you know, waiting 15, 16 hours, seeing these images of other hostages emerging, and then, of course, seeing the gunfire. How do you begin to manage what they're going through?
And a broader question, sorry to interrupt, but, I mean, this was wall-to-wall coverage on five stations yesterday. Mm. I mean, children were walking past and could possibly have caught sight of what was going on? I mean, how do parents then explain that to their kids that this can happen? I mean, it's school holidays.
Yeah, I don't think they possibly caught sight of it. I think they were exposed to it for many hours, and that was one of the issues about 9/11 that we learnt to actually help the community keep it measured in terms of exposure of children to this sort of process. In response to your comment about the families, when I was watching this last night, I was actually thinking about, I wonder if there's parents there that had young children in daycare and preschool and out of school hour care, that they were thinking, I was actually meant to be home for 4 o'clock or 5 o'clock to pick my child up. So someone else has come in and help their child, but then had to go through the explanatory process of where their parent is as well. So there's been a ripple effect within the immediate family, and that's why I said the first step within psychological first aid is actually to promote connectedness, just to have hugs and embrace and physical affection of all your immediate loved ones so that you know you're safe. Then we move on with the process of actually coming to terms with understanding what's happened.
A long road, no doubt.
Yeah, but you speak so much of hope, and that I'll ride with you movement on social media certainly galvanised people.